Okay, this video is going to be an instructional video. I called it the Primer Zodiacal Illumination Reconnect. And when we observe the planets, especially like Saturn and Jupiter, which are behind the Sun within the concave Earth, but they're not as close as Neptune or Uranus. And so Jupiter or Saturn, I took Saturn as an example in this video, sometimes you're going to see different sides of the planet being affected by the shadow or shading, basically. And so what I have here is a top view of the celestial sphere in the center of the Earth. We have in the center, the very center, the primer field. And if you watched my video before, I talked about how in the center I call it the tree of life, and it's sucking in, magnetically sucking in the light. And there's a specific zone at about 33 degrees north and south. Obviously the ecliptic is going to be 23.4 north to 23.4 south, but because it flares out like that at the end, you know, the moon sphere is going to be 5 degrees more plus or minus than the sun as far as latitude goes. And so that's why we get a higher zone in 23.4 with the zodiacal zone. Let's see, Wikipedia, even though they're heliotards, they talk about the zodiacal zone 8 degrees north and south of the ecliptic. Okay, and so you noticed before how I mentioned before that the primer field, the tree of life, it's governing the extent, the 23.4 north and south of the sun as the sunlight returns to the center like that. And so that's why the sun has a governor. It cannot extend to 25 degrees north or south. It's specifically at that angle location like that. And so what's happening with the sunlight, it's reconnecting. The sun is emanating out, and the part that does not hit the ground, it returns back, and it gets sucked back in at the anti-solar illumination zone, the Gegenschein. And so, but also there is going to be other light that gets sucked back into the center as well, just not as severe as the anti-solar region. So that's why we're getting illumination of the planets at specific angles like that. Let's see, in 3D I actually replicated that return area. So it's at about, it's flaring out at the end like that. That gives you the plus 33 and the minus 33, but that zodiacal zone is what we're looking at. And so if we go back to this illustration here, you see how the sun is at the top right there, and I say sunlight, I misspelled that, emanating mostly sideways, gets sucked back to the center. So this planet right here I have as Saturn. And so Saturn, when it's right behind the sun like that, there's no shadow, so it's getting fully illuminated, although it's an ambient illumination, meaning that it's not as bright. That's why Venus is like that as well. When it's directly behind the sun, we're not getting a very, very severe illumination like we do when we see a Venus crescent. Venus, when it's in crescent phase, it's going to be in front of the sun. Venus and Mercury are the only two planets that are in front of the sun. But so I got 12 different sections here and showing you throughout the whole year, as Saturn moves across and it's at different areas in conjunction with the sun. Like over here, I have the shadow on the left side. It's very hard to see, but there's a faint little shadow there indicating that that sunlight, because it's a coronal, horizontal mostly for the most part, that sunlight is emanating on the side, is also hitting the glass sphere. But the light that's not going to the Earth and that's returning, it's getting sucked back in to the primer field in the center, it's going to begin to bend like that. So the magnetism is going to be bending it like that, and so that's what creates the actual shadow angles of Saturn and Jupiter. A little bit more of, not quite as much for Uranus and Neptune, because they're closer to the celestial sphere, so they're getting pretty much, you know, we're seeing pretty much straight on as far as shadows go. So the shadow for the next month over here for Saturn, it's getting a little bit more severe on the left, over here, we see the shadow on the bottom like that over there, and so the sunlight's turning like that. That angle, I should probably fix the angle. It's not quite, it's going to be more erect. So we continue on like that. We see the shadow going like that. Sunlight's bending back to the center like that. There's a shadow over here for that month. And so the sunlight always is going back like that. This is the antisolar Gegenschein zone, where the illumination, they call it Lambertian reflection. Well, that's not really what's happening. It's just being flooded with light, basically. Same thing with the moon. Same thing with the planets. All the planets at the antisolar region are going to be flooded with light like that. And so there's not going to be any shadow. That's when we get a full moon. Okay, so over here, the shadow begins to... The shadow begins to go there on the left, and so on and so forth like that. Let's see the shadow over here, the shadow over there. And when it's right behind the sun, we don't get any shadow. And so, let's see what I got here. Zodiac region 33 north and 33 south. So you see these return lines, all returning to the primer field, tree of life, like that. And so that's why we get the zodiacal region. It's not more than 33 because of, you know, the light is going to be flaring out a little bit more as it gets further away. That's why the moon goes a little bit more than 23.4 each way. It's about 5 degrees each way. And so that's what's happening with that. Let's see here. Oh, yeah, this is how I should, in Stellarium. If I just jump from month to month, right now it's right behind the sun. And I'm just going every month. We see the shadow increasing like that. Then it goes on the other side. Here's a shadow over here, like that. It's also going to, like I said before, I don't know if I said that in this video or not, but the antisolar region, the planet Saturn and Jupiter and other planets, are going to appear larger, just like Mars as well, because they're going to be actually physically closer to the Earth at the antisolar region, and so they're going to appear a little bit larger. You can see how actually Saturn looks larger than it is when it's over here. And so they're going to be closer to the celestial sphere when they're near the sun like that. And the glass in front of them is a positive refraction for the planets and the sun, but it's a negative for the moon. So the moon is reverse. When the moon is closer to the celestial sphere, it actually appears bigger. So that's the perigee. So it's the reverse for the moon. But for the sun and the planets, it's a positive effect going on like that. What else can I explain here? I got a video talking about the zodiacal light. I'll put that link here. See this band right here? It's a very faint band like that. That's why we're getting the zodiacal light, because that light is emanating sideways like that, but it's also hitting the glass sphere, the laminated glass sphere that's in front of the sun and the planets, and so it's going sideways like that. And it converges at the antisolar region, which is the Gegenschein, right? So this is an extension light I did in Photoshop, but it gives you an indication showing how that sunlight is magnetically going horizontally like that. Okay. What else can I show you here? So this is an indication of the light converging on the right there. You see, that's why we get that antisolar illumination zone. But I really just wanted to focus on the primer field and how it sucks that light. See, all the planets are going to be along that ecliptic like that. See all the planets over here? So they're all going to be affected as far as shadows go and illumination and the direction of the shadows based upon how their location is in relation to the sun and taking into account that light that's getting sucked back into the center, which means it's magnetically curving that light and bringing it back to the center like that. Okay. Pretty graphic. So that's what I wanted to explain to you guys. That's how it's working. That's how I fooled modern astronomy. It's a big ruse. It's a big divine ruse. So what I got here? Primer field cups magnetically suck light to center. 23.44 north and south limits direct latitude of zodiacal band. Well, obviously, it's 8 degrees more north and south as you get further away like that. coronal ejection indicates the zodiacal light bend from 33 north to 33 south. Say that there. Okay, well, that's how it's working, guys. Bending light, primer field tree of life, curving the light magnetically, and using laminated refraction as well, and giving you a limit, giving you a region, a zone. It cannot be explained any other way, especially with the glass understanding that's why we get zodiacal light in the first place. But understanding the tree of life that has been hidden from you, from people for many, many thousands of years, that is right there in the center. And so that's the big ruse at play. Okay. All right. Joe. And the sky keeps on turning. For this video, I decided to further clarify the last video that I uploaded called the Primer Zodiacal Illumination Reconnect, showing how we actually have a wheel in the sky of magnetic illuminative reconnection. As you will see, we have the sun rays returning to the central primer field tree of life area. I used the term bent back tulips before in my Beatles Concave Earth video to help describe the rearward path of illumination. Most of the rearward illumination is going to be at the opposition anti-solar Gegenschein region, as the rearward, it's hard to say the word, rearward light converges and gathers in density. However, it's going to return at all circular angles, but less intensely from every radial direction along the zodiacal ecliptic. The zodiac region is said to be about 8 degrees higher than the actual 23.44 north and south degree range, which is due to the high symmetrical onion shapes leaving both sides of the sun, as well as a swelling in declination at the Gegenschein. So the solar corona imagery shows the sunlight emanating horizontally in the shape initially of two symmetric onions. And the magnetic light that finds its way back to the center is guided by the solar / planet glass sphere as it wraps around at various locations according to the angle of the sun it leaves from. The wheel is not literally sectioned into spokes like this, but this is just to show each monthly percent at angles to the central reconnect. Out of all the sunlight that returns to center, the anti-solar light will leave the sun at the greatest frontal range, while the sunlight leaving the sun's rear will leave at the greatest rear angle. I animated the four seasons from winter solstice, when the sun is at negative 23.4 degrees declination, followed by the spring equinox, when the sun is at the celestial equator, then the summer solstice, when the sun is at positive 23.44, and finally the fall equinox, when it's back to the celestial equator at zero. You'll notice that even when the sun is going straight along the celestial equator at equinox time, its ecliptic path is still cocked according to the magnetic ecliptic. Only it reverses angle from spring to fall. Of course, once the light returns to the center, it gets shot back up the vertical Osiris spine that I talked about before. And vents out at the northern apex, traveling up the high arm of light at the top and finding its way back to the sun's rear, which is flat and dark, as I mentioned before. And the process repeats itself, closing the circuit. This is one of the biggest problems for modern astronomy. They have no clue or idea of where to find any magnetic reconnect to the field lines they do observe. So the sunlight that finds its way down to Earth, as well as the sunlight that hits the moon at different angles, you see there with the onion-shaped trumpet of light. So there you have it, good creation, the way the universe really works. Until next time, later. The wheel in the sky keeps on turning.